shot or being fired, and so I'm calling it fire.
Yeah, I'm feeling, man, real high. It's, back in about 1961, 62, and 63, when I think this was, you know, in Congress.
About the idea in general of just taking land away, not what people got for it, but the idea of eminent domain and taking people's land that's been...
When you mention eminent domain, you know, right away you make someone unhappy because the State Highway Department and the federal government, you know, they can condemn land and take it for highways, for military bases, and that sort of thing. And but when you take it for recreational purposes or a national monument or something like that, then you really get people uptight about it. You take somebody that's struggled to make a living on a family farm, you know, a couple of generations, and then the federal government comes in and tells you that, you know, they have the power of eminent domain to take it from you, condemn it and take it. And the only alternative you have is to hire an attorney and go to court and fight them to get a fair price for it. I sympathize with those people because this happened to me, and I know how you feel when, you know, if you've got a home that's maybe is 10 years old, or you've got a farm that you've lived on all your life, and maybe your father and mother lived there all their life. It's there's a sentimental value there that that the appraisers can't put on it because it's illegal for them to put it there, and but it's still, it's there. And there are three ways that they can appraise property, and that's market value, and there's a business approach, and there's one other way that, and I forget now what it is, but there's only three ways that they can appraise property. And income off of property, and Ozark National Scenic Riverway, you couldn't use that. It was, you couldn't. If you go out to buy a motel from somebody or a service station, you can take their net and you can multiply that by 5 years, and, you know, if you can pay for it in 5 years, then that's a fairly decent deal. But the government didn't do it that way. They only paid you for what their property was worth. It was a business on it. They didn't, you know, they didn't give you anything for that. Farms, the first go-round up there in the National Park Service, they averaged $100 an acre for the land, and that wasn't much.
What about the people who report? You said you report when a person came in. Why did people want the National Park Service to come in there?
We were somewhat misinformed on it. We thought it was going to be a park similar to Yellowstone that would bring thousands of people, you know, per week above and beyond what we already had. We were in the tourist business ever since 1942 there at Alley Springs. And under State Park, when Alley Springs was a state park, we had the people. But we thought that there would be more development, more campground go in, that sort of thing would bring more people into the area. I don't think that the influx in tourism has been all that great at Alley Springs. Maybe it has at other points in the riverways. I know it's declined at Big Spring since the federal government took it over. But, you know, it just, in our vision, it just didn't work out to what we thought it was going to be. Monument. somewhere along the way, it was changed from a monument to a recreation area. And the canoe operators, at the time of the, you know, the National Park Service took over, there were 12 canoe operators on the Jacks Fork and Crown River. And now they're approximately 30 on the river. And the plan to limit the canoe traffic on the Jacks Fork and Crown River didn't work out for the federal government. Now there are more canoes on the river than ever have been in the history of either one of those rivers. And I don't know, you know, what their plans are now to control the traffic. I think someday probably they will, but it don't look like, you know, in the next few years they're going to be able to. I don't think the canoe traffic hurts the river. I think probably there were more canoes went down Jacks Fork River this year than ever before, but I think you can go down it now, and I don't think you'll realize that there was all that much traffic on the river. I don't think they damaged the river anyway. There's a lot more aluminum on the rocks, but that'll come off the first flood we had.
I understand from some people that one of the original provisions was to go to the point of the watershed for the Jacks Fork and the current, and people think that there's no way they can do that without controlling all the creeks, and that eventually they're going to come in and try to take the land.
Well, like I said earlier, if they do that, it'll take an act of Congress to do it. They won't be able to just say, well, we're going to spread out. The first original bill, the bill that passed, allowed the Department of Interior to buy a quarter of a mile either side of Jacks Fork or Crown River, leaving 2 miles on either side of Van Buren and Eminence for private development. And I think before the National Park Service can buy any more land, it will have to be a federal bill passed in Congress. And as far as flood control is concerned, the only way that the National Park Service will ever be able to prevent a washaway like we had in 1974 would be a series of small dams, you know, to prevent flash flooding. And I've lived on Jacks Fork River all my life, and that's the only way you'll ever be able to control it.
Are you for a dam on the Jacks Fork?
I was, at one time, I would like to have seen a dam go in at Highway 17 Bridge on the upper Jacks Fork for flood control purposes and for recreation and for power and make the upper Jacks Fork River floatable the year round instead of early spring. I think probably I would still go for a dam at the Highway 17 Bridge. But the federal government claimed that Jacks Fork River would no longer be a free-flowing stream if there was a dam up there. I feel like it wouldn't damage the Jacks Fork River from 17 Bridge down. I think it would make it, if they held the floodwaters in the spring of the year and released them as they needed through the months of July and August, more people would enjoy the upper Jacks Fork. And it's the most beautiful river in the whole country, the upper Jacks Fork. And it's a shame that people can't see it after the water level drops to where you can't float it. And I think that, I still think that a dam up there would be beneficial to the whole south part of the state. How you doing?
Good.
Danny Staples.
Yeah.
Hi, how are you, sir?
Hello.
Good to see you. And how are you, sir?
Where you live at?
Eminence, Missouri. Hello, sir. How you doing? I'm Danny Staples, your state representative.
Hello. You're late. I just voted for you.
Well, good.
You're on the Democrat ticket?
Yes, sir, I am.
I'm Republican, but I voted Democrat.
Well, good. I'm glad to hear that.
Well, I always voted, I used to always vote a Republican ticket, but I just voted mine straight. I'm
well,
a Democrat.
That's the way I vote. Always have.
There's nobody to vote for.
And I'm too old. I'm too old to change now. Hi, how are you? My name. I'm Danny Staples, your state representative. And how are you, sir?
That's
good to see you.
I thought I knew you were.
Oh, sure. Take care of yourself. You going in there to vote?
Now you just vote.
All right. I appreciate it.